the 9th of March 1978, and I'm just on the way to Blurton for the second of my meetings with Alfred Clough.
I started manufacturing at the age of 17 and 10 months. The day was a Saturday between Good Friday and Easter Sunday in 1923. I actually started to work at the age of 13 and 10 months. I worked, my father was a merchant, probably the biggest merchant the industry had ever known. His turnover was something in the region of 150 tons a week, and it accustomed me to thinking big in relation to quantity of pottery. However, on Good Friday of 1923, my father told me he'd bought Carlton Pottery on Southern Road. I was to go next day to take over. I was a fireman at Oldenkin tonight. I had to ask him where the factory was. Next day I went to the factory, bowler hat, blue suit, yellow gloves, to fire an oven. I received well, and told I'd start on the next one. But I got more sense than to go dressed in that manner. In fact, I well knew what oven firing was all about, not by experience, but simply by observing what happened in the potteries. I knew the dirty job. I must have known very well that I wouldn't expect to be responsible for the first oven. Or, maybe, I wanted to make some impression on the people who were there, being a starter. Mm. Anyway, 1923 was my first experience of pottery manufacture directly. In those days, particularly in Longton, most of the factories were either two or three ovens. To have four ovens, that is, two biscuit and two glossed, one was regarded as being established. The bulk of the factories were two ovens. In the case of the china factories, which the majority of the factories in Longton, this meant one biscuit a week, one glossed a fortnight. Because in the case of china with the bedding, the area for biscuit placing was double that of gloss placing. A factory with three ovens, the china factory with three ovens, would get two biscuits a week and a gloss a week. Such a factory would be regarded as being on the way. Now that is, that would be about 3,000 or 4,000 dozen, almost entirely teaware. There were little china dinnerware made in Longton at that time. In fact, yes, Daisy Bank made dinnerware, china dinnerware. I don't remember anybody else. Anyway, my interest is earthenware. And the first factory was a two-oven factory, and the glossed oven was almost exactly the same as the oven that is to be fired by for Gladstone in August of this year. The biscuit oven was 17 foot 9 and 17 foot 9 the shoulder, or a cone type oven. In the case of earthenware, the opposite to china applied, that in fact a biscuit oven would, a biscuit placing would fill about 1.5 times its room in glass placing. Therefore, with one biscuit oven a week, being 17.9, the glass oven only being about 13 foot 6, something like that, I could get 2 glass a week out of one biscuit. It doesn't mean I got twice the capacity. It simply means that by the reason the glass oven being smaller, it made 2 ovens instead of one. The factory was making teaware and jugs when we took it over. Not many jugs, obviously, in a small factory of that kind, a predominance of jugs would be almost nothing in the way of value of turnover. There were 2 flat makers, a bowl maker, 2 cup makers, and 1 saucer maker. 3 handlers, and 2 casters, and a handle maker. That is, as near as I can say, was the potting strength. A good plate maker, and he was a good plate maker, a man named Steele, an old man, with a mould runner and a tower, he would do well to make 80 dozen a day. That is 80 times 12. A 6-inch maker might make 100 dozen. A cup maker with a mould runner and a sponger. The sponger wouldn't really be fully occupied, but that would be the team, would do 30 long dozen a day. That is 90 times 12. A saucer maker would do 240 dozen a week, again with a mould runner and tower. Check, there's something wrong there. Yes, the saucer maker would make 200 dozen, but that is long dozens, being 600 times 12. A good saucer maker maybe would do 240, but it depends upon the effort a man put in. And of course, this was a 48-50 hour week, not a 40-hour week. Compare that with the sort of output that was possible, in fact, was common. In 1972, when I retired, and I think it works out that the output's about 20 times up. Let us calculate that. 90 dozen cups a day for 3 people is 30 dozen cups a day. This is cup bodies only we're talking about. That's 30 dozen a day per person. On the Nash machine, or let's stay with the English machine and take the service machine. On the service machine, 600 dozen a day of one person is common. Mm. That is 20 times, isn't it? Mm. 20 times the output is obtainable today in the case of cups. In the case of cup handling with machines, which are not necessarily too clever, the cup maker in those days was working on the handler, cup handler in those days was working on pressed handles, and the handles were simply one handle in a mould, a roll of clay formed by hand by rolling the clay under a put round the handle, the top part put on, three notched in the mould, and then the girl would press, put a hand on it and put all her weight on to press the surplus clay out into the rigget. And that was how cup handles were made at that time, almost everywhere. Cast handles were they were regarded very suspiciously, were being used in China, where there's less trouble with casting. The casting slip, or a quicker job anyway, in the case of China casting. But the single mould, a roll of clay, and putting all your weight on the top mould, putting the moulds together, two halves of mould together, all the weight on the mould, and wriggling it until the mould fitted in the notches. That was the general method of making handles. I'd forgotten about that. The next handle making that came to be was a metal die. A very similar thing, in fact, with a gas jet under, the top half being fastened to a handle that's on a hinge, also supplied with gas heated, and rolls made on, in fact, it was a sausage machine, so to get rolls made out horizontally, you see. Mm. Finally, we got a wad box for it, a mechanical wad box. But the first thing, a sausage machine, molds allowed to dry a bit, then the rolls allowed to dry a bit, then cut off in lengths, and the clay formed around the die. On the top part of the die banged down, there was a stop on it, of course, so they couldn't go too far, and they made quite good handles.
Very slow, I would think.
It was slow. I was just thinking then it would be no more than 100 dozen a day, and that would be the wads being provided by male labour. Not the girls usually were making handles, and of course they were very quick in picking them out, otherwise they dried on the die, and then cleaning the die was a devil of a job, similar to trying to clear a roller die now. Mm. A roller tool now, if you get it dried on, it's a dickens of a job to clean off. And so we've got that down, and let us look at flat making. It is well possible, if the dryer is good enough now, in 72, to make 400 dozen 8-inch plates in a day, he would have no mould on her. I said 80 dozen a day in 72, in 23, with a mould on her, so that's 40 dozen a day. So in the case of dinner plates, it seemed that the output has increased by 10 times, not 20 times. In the case of saucers, well, 400 times 12 a day is a very reasonable output for a saucer maker. They've got to work up to over 10 a minute to do more than that, but I've had men who've insisted upon having the machine running at 12 and 14 a minute, and have produced regular figures of 600 dozen a day. So we got 600 dozen a day for one person. In the old days, 80 times 12 a day for two persons, that's 40, 600, that's 15 times the output. Now, where's it all gone? Because, anyway, that was the conditions. The dryers were all walk-in dryers, that is to say, they were simply a room with shelves round, most often, in my experience, steam pipes managed off the floor, a stowage on the pipes, and a latticed stowage, and the moulderman would walk across this and put them in the shelves and take them out again, you see. The moulderman would take the plate off the mould in presenting it to the maker, and put aside for the tower who would be working next to them most often. It made a lot of hard work. In the case of dinner plates, there was often, not often, occasionally, people had a third attendant, and this would be a batter out. The spatter was the batter was made in a spatter by the side of the machine, a completely separate movement, but synchronized with the machine in most cases. In some cases, no, it wasn't synchronized with the machine. Separately driven, even though they were built in the same metal frame, they were separately driven, rope driven. That's another point. All the machines on the factory are driven by a rope, and if there came a what was called a rot on, that is, so the splicing was coming out and leaving some spare. And of course that was dangerous because you could get around the pulley and could do anything. They stopped them and stopped it quickly, but of course all the potting stopped until that job was done. So a man on the works who could make a decent job of splicing a rope was very, very important.
So the rope was driven from
a steam engine.
You had a steam engine, did you?
Oh yes, oh yes. Oh yes, I'd throw many of them away. In that case, it was a steam engine. By the side of the set house, which was driving the shaft for the set house, as well as driving a rope for the potters. The set house was an underground shaft, in that case an overhead shaft, belt driven off a pulley on the engine. And we used to have a man, a boilerman engine man, and he also had to do the laundry. Well, you know, wash the overalls, that kind of thing. They only just boiled, and that was it. There's no bother about making them fussy. Most folk took them home, rather than let the boilerman get anywhere near them.
So the rope would have been a terrifically long thing, presumably, to go around all the machines.
Well, up to about 200 yards, something like that. But the point is, of course, that if the boilerman was late, or he couldn't get a draft on his boiler, or couldn't get steam up fast enough, the jigger went slower. And this had all sorts of effects. Effect on the output. Effect on the output of clay, of course, if the machine running slow, if the engine was running slowly. Licking, the tools licking on the clay, not clearing properly because they weren't going fast enough. On this factory at Carlton Southern Road, there was everything was done on the job. No milling, of course, so simply bought mill stuff and bought the clays, her own body, sagamaking. The sagamaker's place was fixed so that his flue fire would go to the same chimney as the boiler stack. It was a simple sort of job, but I got this place going on two blast ovens a week. And to get two blast ovens out of one oven, coal-fired, is no mean task. The turnout from that factory would be about... There's two things that I might have mentioned earlier. That immediately, we introduced dinnerware. I've given about 3,000 dozen a week as being the output of a china glass oven. 3,000 dozen oven, rather. That was all teaware. Now, when it comes to making dinnerware, the counts are smaller, obviously. So on that factory, I think we got to about 4,000 dozen a week. But I wasn't bothered much about anything except getting on with a job at that time. I kept no records. I did my own costing with a very rough sort of costing system, but it worked. But doing the job, washing the job, hardly took any note of the amount of pitches, except that it must be more than half a load. That didn't count pitches. All we did was count what we made and how much money it fetched. It was a simple job, and in 6 months I reckon I learnt my job. Incidentally, I'd taken plenty of night school, of course, for pottery, before I left day school, and after I left day school. But I had no practical experience in manufacture, and my father fixed me up with a manager, a man who had retired, but unfortunately, he was a china potter, not an earthenware potter. My father didn't recognise the difference in this case, and it left me, technically, depending upon my night school training, for almost everything. For practical work, the manager was undoubtedly a very good man. And he fathered me, and I gave him my first inkling into a pottery manufacture.
The night schooling that you did was down at Stoke, presumably.
No, I wanted. Oh yes, afterwards. But I started at the Institute in Longton, Emery. A really good potter. He used to take prelim and ordinary at Longton, the Institute. And at that time he was manager of Lawrence's in Falcon Works in what is now called Lopter Royal Art, what's it called? Part of Bedrick's now. The street. Hard to know.
Coronation?
Along by the Wellington, Duke of Wellington. Opposite the car park, opposite the preaching trailer. Emery was the manager. But I didn't know Lawrence's or Royal Arts all at that time. I was in the merchant business at that time. And Emery was a good man. A man named Grimwade, who was one of the Grimwades from Stoke, took Emery's place in the second year, out of the ordinary, after Emery went to a sanitary works in Scotland. That would be in 1925 when Emery went to Scotland. But the trade lost a good man. And again, from a technical point of view, when I was in trouble or when I was doubtful about my conclusions on the little factory I was running, Emery was quite willing to stay an extra hour at night and discuss things with me. And put me right, or give me more courage, give me more confidence in what I was doing. I owed him a lot. He was a little man. He was 40. He'd never shaved and never smoked. Quite a nice chap. We're well known by people of that time, anyway. People of my age, anyway, who were down there. So I started off with plenty of sails, because my father could handle the sails.
He took all the wear that he produced.
Yes, he took a lot, yes. And the quantity I made was simply as much as I could. That was the only limit. And when we first started, he simply said to me, well, I can do with, you can make 10 crates a couple of weeks, 5 crates of sauces, 5 crates of 8-inch, 5 crates of 6-inch, something like that. And that's how I got my orders, you see. Then I got onto it and got onto my decorating, got the place established, got the slip house. The slip house was not going anywhere there, but we got it going. And in 6 months, we got a factory going at a fair rate. And the factory cost to buy, it wasn't the factory, I didn't buy the factory on lease, but the innards cost £650. And the profit for the first year was £2,000. So that wasn't a bad effort. As a matter of fact, you couldn't match it today, because it would be impossible. We sold it back to the same people that we bought it from, at the same price, about 4 years later, 4 or 5 years later. In 1925, we bought Garfield Pottery, and this was an interesting job. It was a three-oven factory, a bigger factory, much bigger factory than Carlton. There must be 10 machines when we took it over, but it was being converted from earthenware onto sanitary. We had no interest in sanitary, so we started to convert it back to tableware. I hadn't got a job of firing my own ovens at Garfield. There was a fireman already employed there. So I started to try and manage the factory in the proper manner, instead of trying to do everything and everybody being an extension of my own hands. I tried to manage the factory. And I started by examining what was in the glass warehouse to see what wanted doing, you see. Anyway, it didn't take very long to find that that wasn't going to work. The steam engine again was driving a rope, and this rope must have been 400 or 500 yards long. And you could count the jiggers, you could count the speed of the jiggers turning. No man could make a wage on the machine. They were so slow. They were all in very bad condition, and so were the ovens. There's an interesting point here, particularly in relation to firing this kiln at Gladstone. And I may refer to it again more directly. As we get along with the Gladstone kill. But the one biscuit oven, this biscuit oven had been built at about 18 foot diameter. What height it would have been, I don't know. It obviously become in bad condition. And to make it make a cheaper job, instead of taking the inside of the oven away and building another 18-foot kiln, they built a kiln inside the worn-out kiln. Now, here we start off with a cone type oven. What we're starting from the outside, 15 inches of common brick and mortar. In this case, there was 15 inches of fire clay, which had been worn out. A new oven had been built, 9 inches of fire clay inside. So taking the 18-foot kiln, taking the 18-foot oven down to 16'6", lost 9 inches on either side, you see. It had made walls of a thickness of almost 3 foot, if I remember rightly. What did we got? 15, 15 and 9. That's 2'6", 3'3", walls of 3'3". Well, now at Carlton, the oven was properly built and would be 15 and 9. 15 inches of common brick on the outside and 9 inches of refractory on the inside of that touching, of course, built integrally. The oven at Carlton would fire in about 60 hours. It's a fairly light load. When I say fairly light load, I mean there's plenty of hollowware in it. There are plenty of cups as there always were in those days. Another point that I want to mention. That oven would fire in 60 hours, 60, 62 hours, something like that kind. To using thermos bars at that time, 24's bar bent, 23 is a glossed oven, but only 24. I wanted easy biscuit for underglaze decorating. Every piece is underglaze decorated. And about, I think it was 16 tons of fuel that went down to the biscuit for 60-hour firing. At Garfield, the oven was smaller by 1'9", which was important because it's a ring, you see, it's a lot of difference in the upper 1'9" is. But it took 30 tons to fire, and it was not possible to get up to temperature in less than 100 hours. Well, I was fortunate. The fireman who was came with the factory was known to my father fairly well, because had I told my father that I couldn't get the oven up in less than 100 hours and I wanted 30 tons of fuel for it, he'd have thought I was mad. But he would believe the man who had made a living as a farmer for a long time. Yes. Anyway, this oven was built inside a building, inside the main potter shop, in fact, and the floors were simply hanging on corbels built out from the oven. And the same thing by the roof of the shop. Built out on the corbel, built out on the oven to carry the roof. So taking that oven down really meant holding the factory up while we did this. Holding the potter shops up anyway. The big potter shop. And it had to be done. In the meantime, we took one of the ovens, one of the glass ovens as a biscuit oven. Carried everything an extra 100 yards in the open, clayware, all a lot of, and lost money for a few months while the job was being done. But having built an oven 17.9 by 17.9 and got the thing working again, and this cost £750, I referred to before that. This building hanging on the oven cost quite a lot for scaffolding and shoring and connecting up again. That oven went on then firing properly about 6,000 dozen each filling, and I think I'm right in saying it came to 16 tons. It may have been 18 tons, but it went from 30 tons for an oven 50 inches smaller to either 16 or 18 tons for a full-size job, and of course within 70 hours. So we could make a biscuit a week. See, on 100 hours we couldn't do a biscuit a week. So make a biscuit a week, and the biscuit used to fill the two lots. So I got they're bigger ovens than Carlton. At least one of them was, and two a week we got from this one biscuit oven. Now then, in the case of the speed of the making machines, it took time to decide what to do. Again, we've got all these rotten walk-in dryers, and this was long before the Blurton dryer was thought on. There was a Dobbin type of thing being used in some factories, but not an efficient job by any means. And it was simply steam pipes on the floor. Grinley's, Johnson's, everybody was working some sort of dubbing with solid shelves, but not much more concentration wear drying in the same area than an ordinary walk-in dryer. There's nothing to it. Just a little bit better conditions, perhaps. And so we started to get the machines put into decent shape, everything tightened up and so on. Cost perhaps about £2 a machine at that time for a complete overhaul.
Did you do this yourself, or did you get contracted?
No, a little fitter in the town, man who worked himself and his brother, had a shop front as his workshop. Behind it, he put a bit of grease and steel in a barrel of oil or something like that. No more. Oh, men, you'd see men walking about the town, particularly at the weekends, with a spindle on the shoulder, a jig head on the top, and a pulley on, and in the other hand, they would have a toe step. And that's a new toe step collar. The spindle was cone shaped, and it went into a collar. Mm. You see, well, they had to fit. That began to fit, and then of course the jig head had got to run true when it was in. The toe step again had got to fit, otherwise you get a wobble from the bottom, and you'd reckon to get a you reckon that's about 6 months, and then got to be replaced again. So with 26 machines, you have one a week. Is that what it amounts to? But everyone in the town is the same. Everybody using the same kind of tools, you see. Anyway, we decided to split the rope race and put in two motors. We bought these motors second-hand from Richards of Tunstall. I think that the Tunstall end of the potteries must have gone on to alternating current before this end, because these two motors are DC. So they came in, bought from Richards, and being DC motors, a 5-horsepower DC motor was a hell of a big tool. Weighed perhaps 200 weight. Got them upstairs and got them fitted. And this put the and onto a rope again. But the a standard speed on the machines, which helped people a lot. And this is when we started to establish a bit of quality and a definite output per man. And at Garfield, the output speeds I referred for flat and cups and so on were the same at Garfield as I've declared for Carlton. There's a lot of carrying. Clay was carried. There were very few lifts anywhere in the industry in those days, and most of the making was upstairs because downstairs was used for warehousing and placing and sagger storage and that kind of thing, you see. So the potters were upstairs most often, and clay was being carried up on somebody's shoulder, and of course all the clayware made was carried down. And anyway, somewhere about 1930, I think, Barker Street was demolished, well, it was condemned and the houses were emptied. We bought them and made an extension of the factory and put up a second biscuit oven, which made things very much easier. Because before that, we were working on the principle of Tuesday, we do the biscuit oven. During Tuesday, a team of places, one team of places were biscuit and glass, a team of places would be taking the saggers from the emptiers, filling them with clayware and putting them down. We wouldn't finish drawing until 6:30. At that time, the place had gone to have their tea. At 7 o'clock, they'd be back, and the oven would be empty and cleared out. And then they started to run in. And they ran in all the arches and first string and green saggers on the top that night before they went home, and that was 9 o'clock. So they ran in between 7 and 9 over 1,000 saggers. The whole of the first ring in. The next day, they were the rest of the oven was set in and kindled off on Wednesday night. Usually finished firing by Saturday night. Usually finish in the night, Saturday night, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, that's right, 72 hours in the night. Punched out on Sunday. No, punched out first thing Monday morning and drawn on Tuesday again, and that cycle had to go on. And it was balanced in such a way that if the oven was full, properly full, I got enough wear to fill 2 glass ovens, but nothing left.
That accounted for loss as well, did it?
Pardon?
That accounted for loss as well.
If I got an excessive loss, which I did for about 2 weeks on one occasion, we put a new shape of pudding basin in, and it wasn't nesting properly, and I got about 20% loss for 2 weeks, and I hadn't got my glass ovens. Oh, it made a hell of a mess of me. See, instead of my sales being about £500, they dropped down to about £350, because I couldn't get nothing. So that I was in trouble those 2 weeks. There's one thing I'd like to mention here. All right? I'd like to mention here, and that is that I've referred to green saggers going on the top. I've been asked before whether we bought saggers. Well, we didn't buy saggers because if saggers are bought from a sagger maker factory, they were fired empty. Now, we didn't fire them empty, we fired them full. And the load was cups. Box cups and a common iron sagger will hold just as many as a fired sagger. So that you didn't have any part of your oven empty, and your saggers, the firing of your sagger, cost nothing. Because if it hadn't been a green sagger, it had been a fired sagger, you see. So you'd got to make your own saggers, because the manufacturer, a man making saggers for sale, would want to shell him for firing them. But he couldn't afford that.
How many did green saggers would you put in an oven at a time?
Oh, 500.
All on the top?
Yeah, 6 high on the top. But I say 500, this is different shapes, you see. The 17 foot 9 by 17 foot 9 oven would take 2,000 oval common heights. Well, very quickly, if you're doing your job properly, you don't make all ovals. You make the sagger to fit your wear. Mm. And then you make your wear to fit the sagger, you see. So in my biscuit oven, there'd probably be 4,000 saggers. Because a lot of flat saggers, a lot of what I call doodles, which is used to put two bunger 6-inch in or two chambers. But they only took up half the room for an oval sagger, you see. Mm.
Okay.
It is an interesting matter, designing and putting to work the second biscuit oven at Garfield. It was where I really started to design ovens to do the job. So I'll leave that now. Going by my previous experience, in detail, it would be something on these lines. That the oven that I had to deal with up to that time were not new, with the exception of the one that was rebuilt in 1926. That oven was built as big as it could be within the area available. That is to say, there was very little room on the sides of the oven of a square building, although there's room in the corners. Firemouth became lower, the sight hole became lower, but more serious still was the fact that the ash holes, the fire bars, got lower, and the space for air to get into the under the fire bars was very much restricted. Now, where there was not much room between the side of the oven and the wall, it was not possible to dig out a further ash hole so as to make plenty of room between the bars and the floor, because it would have been impossible to get a barrow through the ash hole. It would have been a very difficult matter to do anything at all. So factually, we struggled on with a restricted air supply under the base of the under the fire bars. This applied to 4 mouths on a 10-mouth oven. The effect was that as of the shortage of air, and the air was most definitely restricted, although perhaps I didn't recognize this so much at the time, restricted, the coal burned into oosters, the fire mouth became half full of just dead ash. It is therefore not possible to get a decent load of fuel on for the baiting. It was not possible to keep a 9-inch fire at the thinnest at any time. And generally, it made a difficult matter of firing the oven. So that when it came to building the second biscuit at Garfield, this is on a completely new site. We had bought about 20 cottages, which had been demolished, and we're extending the works over this area. Completely clean site, and the oven was built before any building was put around it at all. It stood there naked when it was built, off a concrete base, up to, I think the height was 60 foot or 65 foot, and there's a story to that. Anyway, in this case, I decided to build the oven without any ash hole at all. That is to say, that the oven was built on a concrete flat without any dip in the concrete flat for the accumulation of ashes. This in turn meant that at least about 18 inches between the concrete base and the underside of the fire bars. This never could get filled up. It never could restrict the air supply to the fuel. Further, I made sure in this case that the oven doors, that is the doors to the fire mouths, that the bottom of the door was at least 6 inches higher than the top of the flues at the bottom of the, for the oven bottom. Also, above the fire bars to the flues at the back, the oven end of the fire bars, I had a 15 inch solid bottom. So I had a case with 18 inches of clear air space under the bars. I had room above the bars for 15 inches of burning fuel without blocking the flues. I could have a reasonable amount of space over the fuel at the top of the mouth. Reasonable amount in this case would be about 3 inches, a hand's width is the usual thing, up to the back arch. And the result was that we could have fired that oven on any sort of fuel that came along with plenty of air. The mouths were hot when they're almost empty, and the oven virtually fired itself. The sight holes, I am 6'3", the sight holes, the peep holes that tell you where how the flame is going above the mouths, were just my eye height. I didn't have to bend me back to look through them, just walk around and look, and it made things very much easier. There's another thing that happened with that oven. It is a beautiful shape, built by Jim Salmons, and they were getting the scaffolding down when the building inspector came along. There was enough scaffolding there, they'd been clever enough to leave enough scaffolding there to just simply put a ladder to it for the building inspector to get up. He had got to measure the height of the oven from the base to the top of the chimney, top of the oven. It was 5 foot short. He made them put the scaffolding back in and put another 5 foot on the top of the oven. Now, I said it's a beautiful shape. It really was a bottle oven, corbelled out in two rings, corbelled out a nice round corbelling where the bottom of the neck starts, and then at the top of the neck, another round corbelling, and of course, as was a habit in those days, the date put on in white glazed bricks, and then about 9 inches above the top corbelling, and that was the finish until the building inspector came along. And he insisted on another 5 foot going on. Well, this 5 foot went on the top of this oven and made a long, narrow draft encourager. I don't know any other way to put it. But most certainly, that oven would have burned old moulds. It was a very easy oven to fire. When the oven was fired, it was simply a matter of raking off the ash off the bars. There was no ooches ever formed in those fire mouths. I tried it with all sorts of fuel, good and bad, and never could make a mistake. There was one mistake, in fact, that I did make on the first firing. I didn't fire it myself on this occasion. At that time I was employing a fireman, and I referred to the clearing holes in the crown of the oven in the case of the oven that would be fired for Gladstone Museum. Now then, these clearing holes, I'm going to be sure, are not too clear in that case, and this is because the second biscuit oven I fired, I covered the clearing holes by half and left half empty. The oven was being fired. I did my normal Saturday night call. I used to call on if I was employing a fire anywhere, I would call at 7 o'clock, and I would call again at 10:30. Where I'd be in the meantime, you can guess. Mm-hmm. At 7 o'clock, when I saw the kiln, the oven, it was working beautifully, right on time, everything just where it should be. At 10:30, when it should have been time to start straightening up for finishing at about 3 or 4 the next morning, it hadn't moved from 7:30. And it was obvious that we were not going to have enough fuel on the works to get the kiln up. We'd lost 5 hours and we hadn't got 5 hours more fuel. So I went home and got changed and went back to the works. Got a wagoner out early in the morning. He got down to the wharf, managed to get in and get some more fuel. And at midday on the Sunday, we had to decide that we weren't going to get this oven any further. We knew quite well what had happened, and so we had to stop. Well, now then, this is a 25 bullet ring, and I wanted about 33. But even when you get a 33 bullet ring in an oven, this doesn't mean the whole of the oven is a 33 bullet ring. Only the trial rings are 33. Now time, at temperature, has some effect of firing. And when the oven was drawn, I was expecting half it to have to go back for refiring. All the flat went through the gauge. And it went on to Glost, and it was lovely stuff. Gave more time, but it hadn't been fired up to 30 bullet ring, as was the standard. But in this case, I'm emphasizing the fact that with a clear ash hole, plenty of air to the fire mouths, plenty of solid bottom under the flues, the fire doors being the bottom of the fire doors being 4 or 5 inches higher than the top of the flues, and it becomes a simple job to fire an oven. In addition, of course, in this case, the oven was not anywhere less than 6 foot away from the surrounding walls, so as you could walk. You could walk round the oven at 5 foot distance instead of, in most cases, rubbing on the side of the oven as you went by. You didn't rub on a fire mouth, you pulled yourself in, you see, but you'd rub yourself by the oven going round. That was a good job. Now then, taking that a little bit further for a moment to prove that there's something in what I say, the next factory that I ran was Royal Art Pottery. Royal Art Pottery, a 7-oven factory, and two of the ovens were 22 foot in diameter. I'm not sure if they weren't 22 foot six or something like that, and a very, very, very great height. They were built for hollowware and had obviously been successful in firing hollowware. But when the war came along, we had to stop making hollowware and stop making fancies and start to make drinking vessels as directed by the Minister of Supply, I suppose to be. Anyway, we made mugs and cups and beakers and mugs without handles, cups without handles, and so on, and did our best in that respect. We were restricted. But when the war was over, we didn't go back to fancies. There's a big demand for domestic ware, and very quickly got on to making flat. The Garfield Works in the meantime had been closed on concentration, and we didn't reopen it. But it was not possible with these big ovens to get anything like a good metal. The firing arrangements were about 30 bullet ring in the top trials, as near 30 as reasonable in the bottom trials. But with this very big, with these very big ovens, it only brought about a 12 or 15 bullet ring metal, that is near the bottom, and the top, which under the crown would be a good 30 foot high, was even lower than that. Well, the top I could have handled, but the bottom I couldn't deal with. So something got to be done about these ovens. I didn't fire these ovens myself at the time. I did fire some of them at different times, but I got too much work to do that time to bother about firing ovens. And I started to alter these ovens into the standard of the second biscuit oven at Garfield. When the ovens were complete, I could only do 2 mouths at a time, 2 mouths between each firing. And these are 12-mouth ovens, so it'd take 6 or 8 weeks, if everything went sweetly, to get this change done. The first mouths were done with those on one either side of the clamming, which is always the worst. That made an improvement. And as the oven was finished and we got the high hash hole, the 15-inch solid bottom, the baiting plate that is the bottom of the door frame, 3 inches above the flue, the oven started to change itself into an oven that fired easily. And the fireman had a jolly good time after that job was done. There were two of the ovens, there were two of these 22 foot six ovens, and they both produced good flatware after they'd been converted. So the importance of air to the to all around the fire, the importance of a nine inch minimum fire thickness anywhere in the fire mouth, and the proper control of draft by opening and closing doors, opening dampers, slides and sight holes is very, very important. It is more important than choosing fine fuels. About 3 years later, I knocked down a small oven, a 14-foot oven. It was ovened and hoveled separately, well over 100 years old, and it took some knocking down. It was so fastened together with heat. This oven had spread, and it also subsided. Anyway, we got it down and put up our standard, 17.9 by 17.9 the shoulder. Except in this case, I made it 18.6 the shoulder. That's only one more sagger all over, but it's another 5%, and it's always worth having.
This was at
Garfield.
Back at Garfield?
Yes.
Which you'd reopened by this
time? No. This at Garfield, before the war, I'm afraid that I did deviate from the second biscuit at Garfield to the alteration of the ovens at Royal Art, rather to prove the fact that a properly designed firemouth, ash hole and so on, would make almost any oven an easy matter to fire, from the point of view attaining the temperature properly, economically and so on. You need a lot of space around the oven and a long hook to have any comfort at all any personal comfort in firing the kilns. But having that is the only reason I went to these ovens at Royal Art. I'll something else to say about those ovens in a moment. But going back to Garfield before the war, I got this glass oven down and built a 17.9 to shelter, a cone oven. This is to say, the oven and oval built together. I never built any other way. Always the oven and oven built together. So this one was built at 17.9, and it was built with this on the same principle as the second biscuit. And again, it was a very, very simple oven to use. The same results as the biscuit that any sort of fuel would do. A nice level temperature throughout and a clean finish. Work almost like a clock at all times. Use the same amount of fuel each time, almost a half hundredweight. The second glass at Garfield, I didn't build. It was built by the people I sold the factory to. The operation of the Garfield works generally may be of interest. This was simply a manufacturing unit. We bought millstock, we bought glaze, we bought colours. But we made pots. And the whole principle of the job was to just make as much effort as we could. And finally, this worked out to be about 9,000 dozen a week, give and take 5%. But the job was balanced in such a way that when the glossed oven was set in at a point, there was nowhere in the biscuit warehouse at all. Every piece that had come from the biscuit ovens had gone into the glossed oven. And the glass ovens were full. There's no humbug about it. The glass ovens were full, but it took every piece that was made, and it was balanced in such a way that every week, I said when a glass oven went in, when a second glass oven went in, the whole of the biscuit supply available had gone into a glass oven. At the same time, there was no packing department there. There was a sales department. We did our own sales, but the packing and the credit control, money control generally, was done from my father's factory, St. Louis Works at that time. Well, Smithfield Works at one time, and then St. Louis Works. And all the stock was taken from Garfield to St. Louis with a horse wagon, just a horse wagon drawing all day long, every day. And before a glassed oven was drawn, if a glassed oven had been drawn on Thursday, on Wednesday night, there wouldn't be enough ware in the glassware house, in my glassware house, Garfield glassware house, to fill a shoebox. And the same thing applied on Saturday lunchtime. We all drew on Monday. On Saturday lunchtime, the same thing would apply. This was the most economic way of doing the job. It was a matter of simply getting on with making and no humbug of any kind. And the sales were carried on my father's business without any extra cost. And as any balance sheet will show, sales and dispatch, when I say sales, I meant dispatch and credit carrying and so on. Dispatch, return crates in those days, credit, all the rest of it was done as part of a bigger job at my father's factory. And we could sell Asian dinner plates white, of which we had very few, at 2 and 3 pence a dozen. That is to say, 11 and a quarter pence today's money. 11 and a quarter pence per dozen, and there were good plates. Underglazed decorative plates, blue band, with a pattern that perhaps everybody remember, it's probably been done somewhere now. Just a blue band, a half inch mazarine band around the plates. They were 2 and 5 pence a dozen. That is to say, about 12 pence of today. Cups decorated, if I could have got one and threepence for them, I'd have been very pleased. Rather, I'd have satisfied one and a penny. Underglaze decorated, this was rubber stamp painting and colour glaze and glaze mottling. All the easy mass production decoration type of thing. Dinner sets were being sold at 6 and 9 pence. A 26 piece dinner set, 3 dishes of the same size. Tea sets were being sold at 1 11 pence a grass edge, and damn glad to get 1 11 pence a. White cups at that time could have been bought. We couldn't make them at that time, but they could have been bought at 11 pence a a dozen boxed. It was a very good experience in just getting on the job. I had 22 machines, hand machines, at Garfield, and sometimes there'd be 10 of them on dinner plates, one machine on dishes, one hand dish maker, 3 machines on cover dishes, 2 or 3 on cups. I think there's been some reference somewhere along about saga making. I don't know if I've covered this, but cups could only be tolerated at the price we get for them by reason of the fact that in the biscuit oven they are fired in the green sagas, and this meant that they were virtually fired for nothing, except that those sagas being full was counted in your costing. But if you did not make cups, you could only put a very light load in and couldn't have filled the area because of the weight, you see. And one would have had to reassess their cost per unit in the biscuit oven, so that they made enough cups to fill the green ones. That was the general principle. Mm. And all green sagas were fired on the biscuit oven because of the better temperature and better life. Mm. Bit of a nuisance carrying them to the glass oven when they wanted, but that's what had to be done.
When you were drawing the oven, how did you do it? Did you use the labour that you got on the works, or did you get casual?
For a long time, we had casual labour. It was casual labour, but our drawing days were definite, and we'd need 10 men. Maybe 8 of them were the same every time, and there'd be 2 strangers. If we didn't get 2 strangers to come along, then somebody had to go and look for them where these men gathered to seek employment. But if someone was placing a drawing in oven for which they were prepared to pay more money than I was prepared to pay for drawing my oven, then I got no team. And this happened occasionally, that I'd have to even take potters off machines to get the oven drawn, and that was a very serious matter. But after a time, it became obvious when we settled down that it became obvious that it better to get our own team on the job, and we engaged a full team of drawing. And as there were 3.5 days a week drawing on average, it only meant 2 days that I got to find work for them. And it helped me very much to keep my factory clean and tidy, and give help where help was required in any department. It was a very good move, in fact, to engage a team of labourers whose job it was to draw ovens and fill in. 10 men on a factory like Garfield to be at the most 160 people. 10 men wandering about for 2 days did seem to be a bit of waste, but it worked out quite well, in fact. Was there anything else on that?
How long did it take to draw an oven?
Oh, well,
what temperature would you go in there?
Well, for drawing, we had the normal thing would be an oven to be emptied once a week, to fill it empty once a week. And if you could get the oven finished on finished firing on Saturday morning, you'd have a comfortable drawing on Monday. But of course, if you got an oven finished firing, then you've got to be placing another one somewhere because of keeping your teams going properly. Well, this happened all right. But the time didn't work out. That didn't work out quite so well as that, and we're often drawing very hot ovens. Now the temperature, measure the temperature, I don't know, but if you hadn't got your hands covered, or you touched your bare back on a sagger that you were standing by, it would leave a whale. It was very hot, and sometimes a man would only go up for 2 or 3 minutes to get the top off, so the next man could go in and be 2 foot lower and take a bit more down, that kind of thing. Work in trousers only, trousers and boots only. Done it myself many a time. But again, somewhere around before 1930, Bailey of Bristol of Birdland Pottery, I think he would be uncle to Richard Bailey, designed a damper, a big damper, and the damper was in fact 6 foot in diameter. It was made in 4 sections and was fastened together with a hoop. The well hole in the centre, the hole in the centre, whatever size you asked for when you asked the damper. Well, then a big hole would be cut into the crown, we'll say a 4 foot hole, and you've got the damper on, so the damper would be overlapping by a foot all the way around. This big damper was very heavy, and had to be counterweighted. And actually, in fact, you adjusted the stamp with a spanner in the beginning. It soon worked out, but that's how it was fixed up, as you adjusted with a spanner. And when the stamp was put on, our instructions from Mr. Burley were, when the fires have gone back, that is to say the oven is fired, and the fireman has a half burnt down, when the fireman says, done, and he leaves it. 2 hours later, the fires are quite low on the bars, or on the ash, whichever it may be. Then is the time to lift the crown damper. That's left a 4 foot hole in the crown. And the movement of air was terrific. No doors were opened, the clamorant were left, the other dampers were left down, so that the cooling was rapid, but it was even, because the fresh air was going in the same way that fresh air had gone in for firing, through the hot ash, until the hot ash became cold ash, through the side holes and the side of the kiln, which was hot until it became cool. But by the time it became cool, cooler air was acceptable inside the oven. Result: we could finish firing at 10 o'clock at night, lift the crown damper, turn up at 5 o'clock next morning, knock down the clamorans, put up the stage and start drawing in comfort.
And you got one of these dampers fixed at Garfield?
On all the ovens. All the ovens. On all the ovens after that, I fixed these crown dampers. Oh yes, I made my own afterwards. But I think I paid barely £150 for this first one. Well, it didn't cost that. He was charging £100 for his patent rights. All right, I paid it once and used it a dozen times. He never came back on us, and that kind. He was quite a decent sort of chap. That was, I think it'd be Richard Bailey's uncle. Actually, the damper bricks were made of Furnivals, who were Burleys again. Probably cousins to. No. Now they're another bit of my father's age. Maybe Bailey, I'm referring to, be great uncle to Richard Bailey. And these people at Furnival would be uncles. At that time, if you're not referring to that time, they made the dampers, made the bricks rather. And I bought bricks from them afterwards got my own blacksmith to fix them up and did some. Never made a mold for the bricks. But firing was the trouble. Never fired them hard enough, really. But anyway, this meant that you could finish at 10 o'clock at night, finish firing at 10 o'clock at night and start drawing at 6 o'clock next morning. Now, for drawing time, it took us a full 12 hours less, 1.5 hours being meal times, to draw a biscuit oven. And it was very hard work, even so. The biscuit wires were right by the ovens. There was no big carrying job. The saggers were being taken from the oven by places who were placing into another oven. So a lot of work was saved there. But the weight, you see, there'd be about 7,000 dozen in those ovens. and I reckon the weight would be about 7 pounds a dozen. £7 a dozen. That's a fire. That'd be the fired weight. 7,000 dozen. So that's 49,000 pounds, or something like 20 tons. That was ware. So you can reckon there's 20 tons of ware and 30 tons of saggers, at the very least. So that's 50 tons are being moved, and being moved by hand, no conveyors and anything, being moved. Only short distances, but they're being moved, hot conditions, because the ware in the saggers was hotter than the atmosphere, you see. And they'd be moving 50 tons with them to the biscuit oven. And the glass oven, I suppose, would be maybe 40 tons. Now, the glass oven with cranking and dottlers and so on, we never could get the bigger oven cleared in a day. The smaller oven we could do in a day, or less than a day. But the full-size 17.9 oven, we never could get cleared away in a day. And in that case, the oven was by the biscuit warehouse, and the ware was taken from the saggers and put into the biscuit, into the glass warehouse for warehouse women to take away. There's no carrying there, but carrying the saggers away and all the rest of it, looking out for thimbles and so on. It was a hard work, and we never got that cleared in one day. We get the oven empty in the day, but the sun was set down that there was, well, this is where this team of drawers came about, you see. It was very useful. There's something on the do and clean up. But with the same sort of ovens at Alfred Meekins, for instance, at Rathman's, what they call it now, Newfield, I've seen them in Newfield, a lot more men, they'd have 20 men on the job, drawing ovens quite hot, and I've seen them setting down, but I've seen them start normal time in the morning and have the oven cleared away and cleaned up by 2 o'clock. Plenty of men about, you see, and plenty of room. I built my ovens as big as I could in the room I got available, and I had shorter room for other things all the time. Anyway, that's just something else. It's firing the ovens, really, that's the most interesting part of the job. And of course, meeting targets all the time. And it's a target every day. My mother once said, once burst out of my father and said, "Ovens, ovens, ovens, it's always ovens with you." Because when my father and I talking, we're always talking about ovens. And she got fed up with the conversation of ovens. And she stamped out. So that's the only time I've been able to show a temper. But she was annoyed that day. I suppose she got something else she wanted to get discussed. And wasn't getting on very well. Garfield was closed under concentration. Another experience of Garfield was that the coronation, I think it was, not coronation, Jubilee, George the Fifth Jubilee. I think this was 1935, am I right? You wouldn't know. I think it would be about 35. Now, before that time, I'd done the building on the extension, and I had to get some more cup handlers. And I had the cup handlers come along, and then the Jubilee came along.